The goal of this video is to feed you as much information as we possibly can. How the instruments are built, what woods we use, the fact that these are the musical woods that have been used through history. Mahoganies, Brazilian rosewood, alder, curly maple. I'd like to show you some of the theories behind the guitars, how they're made, some of the processes, some of the custom machines, our different pickups. You'll get the chance to see them made and to hear them. I'd like to show you the tremolo and all its different features. You'll get a chance to visit our finish room and watch the craftsmen spraying sunbursts. We'll get to talk about the different aspects of the finishes and why they're the way they are. The craftsmen at PRS Guitars are not just guitar makers, but guitar players. Our whole focus as a company is to build an instrument that feels, sounds, and looks the best that it possibly can. You'll notice the care that each of the people use when they're working on the instrument as if it was their own, because they're guitar players, they understand. I'm going to be as informative as I can so you can make a decision for yourself of whether you like PRS instruments. So let's start the tour. PRS Guitars is 10,000 square feet of factory and office in Annapolis, Maryland. We have 55 employees, most of which are guitar players. Everything starts here in the wood room. For the backwoods of the gluing guitars, we use mahogany. These backs go through a special drying process. They sit around the factory for a long period of time to get bone dry in our humidity-controlled environment. For the backs and bodies of our bolt-on guitars, we use alder. History has proven alder to be a very musical wood. Alder goes through the same drying process in our factory as the mahogany backwood. We want it to be dry, resonant, and free of flaws. One-piece mahogany is used for the necks of the highline instruments. It's been my experience that the best-sounding necks have been made of one piece. All PRS guitars are made with this construction. These neck blanks go through a special drying process. The goal of this whole drying process is to have a neck that will be straight for a lifetime. To demonstrate how strong this neckwood is, watch one of our employees try to break one. For the bolt-on guitars, we use hard maple. That's also called rock maple, sugar maple, it's all the same thing. It has a harder tone than mahogany, but very good. These neck blanks go through the exact same drying process as the mahogany. The glue-in neck guitars at PRS use Brazilian rosewood for fingerboards. PRS is the only company in the United States using Brazilian rosewood. It's a musical wood through history. It's what they used to make marimbas out of. It's got a gorgeous tone when you strike it in the rough. We use precision jigs and a very special adhesive to glue on our fingerboards. It's my theory that if you glue on the fingerboard right the first time, there should never be a reason to change it. On the bolt-on guitars, we used East Indian rosewood. When we were developing this instrument, East Indian rosewood gave the guitar the kind of mid-range we were looking for. Also available are maple fingerboards. Maple fingerboards give our bolt-ons a very warm, high, mid-rangey tone. All of our fingerboards have a 10-inch radius. Fender, in the 50s, used a 7.5-inch radius, which would have been more round. And Gibson, on the other hand, would have used a slightly flatter fingerboard. Through our experiences as guitar makers, we found that the 10-inch radius was the best compromise. The fingerboard feels plenty round, but the strings do not buzz out when you stretch them. On our mahogany neck guitars, you have a choice of two inlays. You can get our traditional bird inlays, which have become our trademark over the years. Or you can get moon inlays. If you look very closely, you'll see that it looks like a dot, but it's not. You have a piece of pearl, which is in the shape of a crescent moon, and a piece of abalone, which is in the shape of a waning moon. They both fit in the same hull. The maple-necked instruments come standard with abalone dots. Curly maple tops come out of many different kinds of boards, but our most common is a thick board. The board is sliced right down the middle. You literally open it up just like a book so that the grain is perfectly matched. We grade all of our curly maple tops. Our first grade, which we call regular classic, comes on the bolt-on instruments. On a scale of 1 to 10, it runs about a 7. Then, on our glue-in guitars, we have our regular grade of curly maple, which would be anywhere from, say, on a scale of 1 to 10, 7 to 9. Then we have our 10 tops. These are clearly marked on the back of the headstock next to the serial number. On a scale of 1 to 10, we think it's a 10. The last and final grade is signature series. The rule of thumb here is something spectacular. About 1 in 1,000 maple trees are curly. It's part of the genetics of the tree. The wood actually grows curly. If you take the bark off and run your hand around the tree, it ripples just like the curly maple does. An extremely curly log will actually be curly in the bark, and you can see it standing in the forest. And so we've developed a whole lot of colors to go with the color of the curly maple. Red stains become black cherry. Gray stains in the curly becomes gray-black. Green stains become emerald green. Brown stains become tortoiseshell. And the woods have dictated the colors to us. We use a thicker top than most instrument makers, almost 7/8 of an inch thick. This is necessary because of the depth of the carve on PRS instruments. Our finish room is divided into three different sections. The spray room, where our craftsmen take great pride in spraying our sunbursts, color coats, top coats, and sealers. An area we call the sanding hall. The desired goal is to have the instrument look like it was dipped in glass. How well the instruments are sanded plays a great role in this outcome. We use a combination of vintage and modern finishing technologies to get our high gloss finish that feels like old lacquer. Our bolt-on instruments have the same finishing technology on the bodies, but the necks are done a little different. It has the feel that the new players like. PRS finishes are particularly thin, so the instruments will be as resonant as possible. The sanders and buffers have to be particularly careful, because to rub through on these thin finishes is quite easy. We think it's worth all the extra work. We've built many sophisticated machines and jigs and fixtures at PRS. We had to literally go to the drawing board, draw them, and manufacture them. This is our duplicarver. On this machine, we cut all the holes in the back for the tremolo and the electronics cavities. We carved the tops, put in pickup holes and neck joints. Here is our custom fingerboard slotting machine. 25-inch scale, takes about 3 seconds. The inlays are glued in with Brazilian rosewood powder and epoxy. Here, our inlay artist is cutting the holes to accept the bird inlays. In the assembly department in the wood shop, necks are checked to make sure that the carve is exactly right. Fingerboards are checked and rechecked to make sure they are dead level before fretting. Welcome to the sanding table. Bodies here are sanded completely scratch and bump free. It's a much more difficult task than you might think. But in order for our finishes to turn out, this job has to be done just so. This is our staining table. The people at this table are very careful to make sure that the stains are just right. You have to work with the wood and the amount of stain that you use to have the color jump when the instrument's finished. Right before the instruments are buffed, they're wet sanded down to 1,000 grit paper. If you rub it with your fingers, it almost feels like just a piece of paper. Not something you would consider to be a sandpaper. It's that fine. The goal in final assembly is to have an instrument that plays perfect right out of the box with no adjustments. We spend a lot of time getting the fingerboards to feel as if the instrument's already been played for 10 years. In assembly, the instruments are checked and rechecked. We install the pickups, electronics, hardware, strings, tuners, nut, all of which are custom-made parts. Since we all play guitar, there's a lot of feedback that goes on between the employees, letting us know how each musician feels about new models, new pickups, new ideas. Each employee has a checklist which he goes through to ensure quality control on the instrument he's working on. The original reason we started making our own pickups was because what we wanted out of a pickup was not commercially available. As a result, all our pickups are made in-house to our exacting specifications. Bobbin molds, screws, pole pieces, magnets, wire, everything is special ordered. Now what I'm going to do is demonstrate all of our different pickups. We're going to go pickup to pickup to pickup to pickup with exactly the same guitar, same amplifier, same cable, same amp settings. We won't touch anything except change the pickups in this instrument. The first example I want to do are our standard pickups. So our standard pickups are warm, PAF sounding humbuckers with extra high end on the top. And first I'll demonstrate the treble pickup. This is our standard treble pickup. It's warm and sweet on the high strings, but it has lots of highs on the low strings. So what we've tried to create is a pickup with like single coil high end on the bass strings and a very sweet tone on the high strings. Our standard bass pickup is the same thing. It's a PAF sounding humbucker, but with extra high end bite on the top. You can hear that high end bite. It's real good when you're using a lot of effects and you need the tone to get through all the effects. You still want to have tone, but you also want to hear the effects. It's real good for that. It's real good for home studios, real good for a top 40 environment where you need Strat tones and Les Paul tones at the same time. Real good if you want to cut through on the tape and there are a lot of people in the band. Very good if you've got a lot of pedals on the floor and you need that extra high end. Vintage treble pickup. Our vintage treble pickup sounds very much like a PAF. It's not the most powerful pickup in the world, but very clean. Most of your good rock albums have been recorded with pickups very similar to this, you know. You can hear every single note. It's not the most powerful thing in the world, high gain, but there's a lot of tone there. Vintage bass pickup. Our vintage bass pickup sounds very much like an old PAF. It has a very pretty single coily tone, very much like you're playing in a big metal pipe under the road. Very beautiful tone. And as you turn it down, it stays very pretty sounding. Also, if you turn it all the way up and you turn the tone control off, it has kind of a singing tone. Very much like old Cream. Deep Dish 2 treble pickup. Sounds a whole lot like an old P90. Has a single coily tone, a lot like, say, Leslie West tone, you know? It's got a real fat tone, but it's a little bit single coil. It's not something you'd normally hear in a humbucker. HFS treble pickup. HFS stands for Hot, Fat, and Screams. It's our very powerful, strong sounding pickup. It's got that power chord tone, some big, fat, warm pickup. I really like it. It's got a lot of scream, but everything's there. Still on the low notes, it's nice and fat. But plenty of highs. HFS2. Our HFS2 pickup is our metal version of the HFS. It has a 100 hertz bump in the bass, real thumpy, thump, 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 with a lot of very powerful mid-range, maybe our loudest pickup overall, and a very sweet high end. It'll take an amp that's very trebly and maybe a very crunchy on a high end to sweeten it up, but also sound very powerful. Real good for a lot of the metal music that's going on now. Good pickup. Treble pickup, that Leslie West thing, you know. Then the next one is the vintage treble pickup, which is a little thinner. One's real good for, say, rhythm guitar, which would be the vintage treble pickup. Next one's great for solos. Deep Dish for solos, vintage treble for rhythm. The next position is one of the Strat tones, you know. And very next one, very next to the end, is the thinner version of that. The last position is the vintage bass pickup, that thing that sounds like a pipe under the road, you know. That's with the tone control off, with the tone control all the way up. So you can go and get a variety of tones that are similar to each other, but when you're playing in a band, really have different kinds of character. Deep dish 2, vintage treble, thick strat tone, thinner strat tone, vintage bass, our multi-tap system. This is one of our studio guitars, two single coils and a humbucker. And I'd like to go through the sounds on this instrument now. On the rotary, all the way up, is the treble pickup. And this is our hot vintage pickup. It's the only instrument we put this model pickup in. The only way I can describe it is sweet. The reason we use the hot vintage pickup on this guitar is I think it's a real good match for the single coils. The second position is this coil and the middle coil together. Third position in the middle is the middle pickup. The next and next to the last position are these two pickups, you know, that old strat tone. The very last position is the bass pickup. So you got quite a variety of tones, two single coils and a humbucker, our studio. On many models of PRS guitars, we offer something called a sweet switch. Now, what a sweet switch is, it's an imitation of about 35 feet of extra jack cord. It takes the tone down about an octave. It's like pulling a wah-wah pedal back maybe a third of a cuck. So without the sweet switch, you would get a tone like, and with it in, it's, so it goes from ah to aw. It's got that more of a, it's got more of a bark to it, really. That's with it in, and that's with it out. The idea was, if you have a pickup that's too trebly, or you have an amplifier that's real shrill and you want to warm it up, you want to get that old fat tone, hit the switch, you're right there. I'd like to do a rotary switch demonstration. Now, our rotary switch is kind of the heart of the PRS electronics. You can get a whole lot of different tones with the same two pickups. Kind of like to go through that with you now. The first position all the way up is the treble pickup. The next position all the way up and one off are the outside two coils. The third position are the inside two coils in series. The fourth position are the inside two in parallel. And the last position is the bass pickup. I'll go through those now. Treble pickup, HFS, that's what comes standard in a CE model, bolt-on guitar, sounds like this. The next position, which is the outside two coils, is very much like an acoustic guitar. Maybe a little bit Telecaster sounding. The next position, the inside two coils in series, is a warm version of the in-between pickup sound on a Stratocaster. And turned down, it's that, you know, sound, but a warm version of that. The next one are the inside two coils in parallel, which is a thinner version of that in-between Stratocaster sound. Turned up, you know. The last position, the bass pickup, our vintage bass pickup in our bolt-on instruments, sounds like this. Now, to all these positions, you can vary the tone with a tone control. It's a straightforward, simple tone, just rolls off the highs. So, so So you can go from this treble pickup to the strat tone without ever touching the amplifier. Looks great. On our guitars, we offer three different shapes of neck. The first, our regular neck, is somewhere between an old Telly and an old Les Paul. It's more of a round neck. And an instant way for a salesman right in the store to be able to tell the difference is the heel is very round. On our wide, thin neck, the second neck we offer, the heel is much smaller in the back, and it's much more like an old dot neck 335 neck, our wide, thin neck. We sell a lot of these, especially in bolt-on models. In our high lines, regular necks consist of maybe 60-65% of our sales. We offer one other neck, which is what we call our wide fat neck, and we'll put these on a lot of our artist guitars. It's the width of a wide thin neck, but a little bit thicker front to back. Not quite as thick as our regular neck, but it's a good meaty neck. So you have three necks. Our regular neck, somewhere between an old Telly and an old Les Paul. Our wide thin neck, which is very similar to an old 335 dot neck. And a wide fat neck, which is the width of a wide thin neck, but a little bit thicker front to back, more of a meaty neck. I want to go through the tremolo now. As far as I'm concerned, a tremolo should not go out of tune. Stay in tune, right? Anyway, there's a lot of reasons why our tremolo stays in tune, and I want to go through them with you piece by piece. First, let's do the tuners. This is our patented tuning peg. If you notice, there are no winds around the tuning peg whatsoever. It makes sure that the tuning peg doesn't loosen up or tighten up. It's like welding the string in tune at the peg. And the way it works is this. You loosen the string, and you push on the curved side of the collar, and the string just pops right out of the peg. If you want to put it back in, you put it in the slot, turn the peg, and it locks up all by itself. You'll push on the straight side just a little bit to lock it up a little bit better, and the guitar is in tune. See, the thing I couldn't stand about tremolo systems was if I was late for a gig, say I showed up at 20 after and the gig started at 9:30 and I only had 10 minutes to change strings, if I had to mess with all that Allen wrench stuff, I'd never play. And I can get these guitars de-strung, put new strings on, clip them, tune them, get in tune and working within about 7 minutes, which is really unheard of. And the other thing was if you broke a string and you didn't have an Allen wrench at a gig, you were screwed. So it was very important to me to have something that was dealable with just common tools, a pair of wire cutters, and if you didn't have wire cutters, you could still change strings, no problem. The next thing I want to talk about is the nut. We have a very low headstock angle. The strings curve over the nut just enough that the strings don't buzz in the nut, but there's enough there that you get a good tone from the nut forward. Also, you want as little friction as possible. If the headstock angle is too much, you'll get too much friction in the nut. If it's not enough, you'll get it to buzz. So I think we put it exactly in the right place. We make the nut out of a material that's very low friction. A lot of people ask me what it is. We don't tell them. It's one of the only secrets we keep. They last forever. We've replaced maybe two or three in the whole history of the company for wear. And it's been working real well for us. The next issue is the bridge is on a knife edge. Now, the way this works is a little bit hidden. In the shaft of each one of the six screws in the front of the bridge, there's a little slot. And there are six holes in the front of the bridge that are countersunk from the bottom. So you have a knife edge at each one of the holes, and that knife edge fits into the slots in the screws. So the bridge never actually touches the body. It rides on a six-point hidden knife edge that we oil, so it comes back always to the same place. This is very important because if the bridge doesn't come back to the same place, the guitar won't stay in tune. The next issue is the arm. You want the arm to stay wherever you put it, and you want its tension adjustable. The tension is adjustable from a screw in the back of the bridge. And
this arm's not going to break. It's not threaded. You just slide it in, put it wherever you want it. It's made out of stainless steel. It's not going to rust. And if you have any troubles with it loosening up, which I doubt, all you got to do is tighten up an Allen wrench in the back. The next point of the tremolo is that we've angled the saddles back so that when you rest your hand on the bridge, you feel the string under your hand. You don't feel bridge saddle. It's very much like the way strings feel when they go over, say, a tunematic style bridge. You rest your hand on the bridge and you can mute them or not mute them however you want. You get the feel of the string in your hand without screws sticking up into the bottom of your hand and without these screws ever rusting because we make them out of stainless steel. We also plate the bridges with nickel. Now, my experience of nickel is that it doesn't peel off and it lasts a long time. The issue here is I want a bridge that's going to last forever and not rust or peel. So we use a thick nickel plating, and I think it works very well. The next thing we do is we drill out the block of the bridge. Now, the ball of the string rests very close to the top of the bridge here. If you look down in the hole, the twist lock is just about to come up over the saddle. That way, when you stretch up a string, a whole lot of string isn't stretching up over the saddle and sticking. And when you bring the arm down, string going back down over the saddle. This happens on a normal Stratocaster when the ball of the string rests right at the end of the block. But when you drill out the block, most of that problem goes away. There are some tricks to keeping the guitar in tune like I'd like to show you now. On our most recent guitars, right here in a shallow tuning peg is a white washer. Now, on these tuning pegs, it's been taken out. When you take it out and you tighten this button up very tight, the guitar stays much better in tune. Also, you have six collars, and on each side you have a straight side and a curved side. It's important that after you take and stretch the string, that you push on the straight side just a little bit to lock the string up better. Then you go, stretch the string, bring the arm down, and tune it up. It works real well. The last thing is you want to tune with the arm. What you should do is tune all the strings on a strobe, stretch the strings a lot, stretch them up, bring the arm down, tune it, stretch them again, stretch them out by hand, bring the arm down, and then tune the guitar. And then at the very end, bring the arm down and back, and then touch tune it. That means that if the guitar ever does go out of tune, if you bring the arm down and back, it'll come right back in tune, and this is a very important point. Normally on a passive volume control, when you turn down from 10, anywhere below 8, you lose high end. That's normal. But on our volume pot, we have a capacitor that bleeds a little high end over, so that when you come down between, say, 4 and 2, there's extra high end on the signal. So if you're playing through an amp, and you turn it down so the amp's not distorting anymore, you gain a little bit of high end so it's nice and clear. It's a nice little feature our volume control has. If you don't like it, it's easy enough just to go in with a pair of wire cutters and cut the capacitor out. But most people really desire it. Check it out, it's a good feature.
Here are the different colors we offer. Vintage Yellow, Vintage Cherry, Vintage Sunburst, Tobacco Sunburst, Black Sunburst, Tortoise Shell, Emerald Green, Whale Blue, Royal Blue, Scarlet Red, Black Cherry, Gray Black, Natural Mahogany, Electric Blue, Electric Red, Black, Black with white binding, dark blue, and pearl white. The business end of PRS guitars is a blend of real people and computerized control. Each instrument is followed down the line by its made-to-order schedule and checked off as it goes, so everything the customer wants is there and right. Our telephone sales staff are caring individuals who know the business. They make outstanding sales support their everyday job. You can count on them. We know this was a lot of information, so if you have any questions, we can be reached at PRS Guitars, 1812 Virginia Avenue, Annapolis, Maryland, 21401. I really appreciate your time watching this video. Thanks a lot.
My name's Paul Reed Smith, and I'm here to introduce you to our new products, the PRS amplifier line. We have our new 212 combo, our new top, and our new 412 cabinet. We're going to run through a whole bunch of different sounds that these amplifiers can get on this video. And to start, I've got an old friend, Mr. Michael Ault, one of DC's best guitar players here to demonstrate the combo. Michael's an expert in combo playing. He's been doing it in the clubs in DC for years. First, we're going to start with a blues tone. Michael, let it roll. Michael, let's go for a country tone. Maybe take a little mid out, a little gain out, some treble up. Try that. Michael, let's go for a jazz tone. Turn up some bass, a little less mids. Michael, let's go for a little bit more screaming blues tone. Let's switch channels, go to the higher gain side. Why don't you roll? Michael, let's go for an LA sound. I think the blues side, American voice side of the amplifier would be best. Give it a shot. Thank you. Michael, let's go for a crunch rhythm tone. Same channel, more gain. Go for it. Michael, let's go for something screaming. I'm going to turn the gain all the way up on a red side. Roll. I'm here to show you the new PRS top. Now our top is exactly the same as the combo. It's the same amp, just turned upside down. Your input's at the right, and on the combo, the input's at the left, same amplifier. The real difference is in the cabinet. The cabinet is a 412 tight, punchy sounding cabinet, and our combo is more, has more of an open sound. Now, you can get all the sounds that you got out of the combo out of this amp, and 412s lend themselves to some things I really like, and I'd like to demonstrate that to you. If you take the red channel, turn up some gain, turn up some volume, maybe the treble and presence in the middle, use your bass pickup and turn the tone control all the way off, you can get this gorgeous tone. Beautiful old cream tone. I really like that. Now, if I turn my tone control up and treble pickup on, it's that rock and roll tone. You know? You get a good screaming tone out of it. If I go to the clean channel, you can get a gorgeous rhythm tone out of this amp. And that same channel, if I just turn the guitar all the way up, real screamy lead tone, but all out of the same channel with just changing the volume on your guitar, not having to really channel switch. Okay, there's one other tone I wanted to show you. Red channel, turn the gain all the way up, treble all the way off, mid all the way up, bass all the way up, presence all the way off, and some volume. It's a real singy kind of like Carlos tone. Singy, beautiful tone. It's got a lot of highs, good mids, solid lows, and it's a lot of gain. I really like that. All players have different styles. My favorite combination is the top and 412 cabinet, and Michael's favorite combination is just the combo by itself. Also, another rig would be real good is the combo on top of the 412. You use the combo at your rehearsals or at practice, and then when you go out and play live, stick the combo on top of a 412, and it's just a barking 612 stack. I think you should go into your nearest PRS dealer and try one of these amps. I think you'll like them. Thank you for your time.